I want to share some of the ideas that you came up with related to planetary habitability. So some of the ideas that I saw popping up were that you might want to have a planet that has an atmosphere with some greenhouse gases in order to be, you know, warm like the Earth, maybe a similar temperature to Earth, but maybe you don't want too many greenhouse gases so that you don't end up with a runaway greenhouse effect that boils away all your oceans. You might want to have a low enough equilibrium temperature to start with to make that runaway greenhouse effect less likely if water is the greenhouse gas that kind of spurs that runaway effect into action. You probably don't want a toxic atmosphere. Yes, that seems helpful. You probably don't want, for example, sulfuric acid clouds, because that would be extremely caustic to the life forms that we're familiar with, at least. You might want to have a similar atmospheric pressure, though arguably life forms could evolve to be able to withstand different atmospheric pressures. The reason I say that is because there's life forms that evolve to live under high pressure under the sea, and they die when we bring them to the surface. You might want to have a magnetosphere so that you're protected from solar winds. Yes, I would find that important. And then maybe you want plate tectonics on your planet to help sequester CO2. So is plate tectonics necessary or a nice to have for habitability? Well, there's plenty of things that it provides. In order to drive plate tectonics, you need to have a crust that's cooler than your core. And so that's usually going to happen if your core is a hot molten liquid. And so it kind of goes hand in hand that most planets that have a strong magnetic field would also have plate tectonics, at least on terrestrial planets. Venus, I didn't mention this before, does not have a strong magnetic field. And it does have a liquid core. That's why it's still, you know, driving enough heat to the surface to convect the mantle and result in the ongoing volcanic activity that we see specifically in the sulfur dioxide in the atmosphere changing over time. But it doesn't drive a magnetic field because it has a very slow rotation. So it doesn't establish that same dynamo effect that we have to produce the magnetic field on Earth. Okay, so plate tectonics and magnetic field can go hand in hand. So if you might want to see tectonic activity on an exoplanet, if you want to, you know, a way to look for a magnetic field at a distance. Okay, it's useful, as you mentioned, because it helps sequester CO2. The rock cycle is an important way to lock the carbon that's in rocks into the planet for good. Well, until volcanoes spew out some carbon dioxide in the form of gas when they erupt. Also, just like really practically, if you want different, you know, maybe you want your planet to have landforms. Not that all life needs to be land-based, but it might be nice to have different environments for different kinds of life forms. And plate tectonics definitely provides this. There's all kinds of different environments on Earth, thanks to plate tectonics providing mountains and valleys and underwater heat sources and all kinds of other things. You know, the boundaries between land and water are often some of the most biodiverse places on Earth. And thanks to plate tectonics, we have that boundary.